Good evening, everyone. It's great to be in the house of the Lord. It's good to see each one this evening. Look for another good night of preaching and singing. Take your hymnals and let's all stand for hymn number 31. Hymn number 31, He Lives.
I serve a risen Savior, He's in the world today. I know that He is living, whatever man may say. I see His hands of mercy, I hear His loving tune. And just the time I need Him, He's always near. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know He lives. He lives within my heart. In all the world around me, I see His loving care. And though my heart grows weary, I never will despair. I know that He is leading through all the stormy blast. The day of His appearing will come at last. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. Rejoice, rejoice, O Christian, lift up your voice and sing. Eternal hallelujahs to Jesus Christ the King, the hope of all who seek Him, the help of all who find. None other is so loving, so good and kind. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know He lives. He lives within my heart.
Amen. You may be seated. Take your hymnals and let's turn over to hymn number 147. Hymn number 147, Leaning on the Everlasting Arms.
What a fellowship, what a joy divine, leaning on the everlasting arms. What a blessedness, what a peace is mine, leaning on the everlasting arms. Leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alarms. Leaning, leaning, leaning on the everlasting arms. Oh, how sweet to walk in this pilgrim way, leaning on the everlasting arms. Oh, how bright the path grows from day to day, leaning on the everlasting arms. Leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alarms. Leaning, leaning, leaning on the everlasting arms. What have I to dread? What have I to fear? Leaning on the everlasting arms. I have blessed peace with my Lord, so near, leaning on the everlasting arms. Leaning on Jesus, leaning on Jesus, safe and secure from all alarms. Leaning on Jesus, leaning on Jesus, leaning on the everlasting arms.
Amen. At this time, we have a special, and we have four gentlemen that are going to sing I'm Standing on the Solid Rock. That's a quintet.
That's right.
Through my disappointment, strife and discontentment, I cast my every care on the Lord. No matter what obsession, pain and deep depression, I'm standing on the solid rock. From all the storm that rages, rich enough from Satan's wages, I'm standing on the solid rock. Even though he's gone now, I don't feel alone now. With comfort came the Spirit of the Lord. Now with his word to guide me, from temptations hide me, I'm standing on the solid rock. I'm standing on the rock of ages, saved from every storm that rages, rich up from Satan's wages, I'm standing on the solid rock. Now I'm pressing onward, each step leads me homeward. I'm trusting in my Savior day by day. And close to no relation, firm in his foundation. So on this solid rock I'll stay. I'm standing on the rock of ages, safe from every storm, from all the storm that rages, rich in love I'm rich, but not from Satan's wages, I'm standing on the solid rock, standing on the solid rock.
Amen. I don't know if they convinced me to do that or I convinced them to do that, but praise the Lord. It's good to sing with brothers in Christ, and we sure do have a great Savior to sing about. And thankful for what the Lord did this morning in our hearts, and just a great start to our revival meeting, and looking forward to what the Lord's going to do all week long. And I just want to encourage you again to commit to the Lord to be here as much as you can this week. And I've always tried to make that a priority, that I'll be in the Lord's house. The doors are open unless I'm providentially hindered. And just pray that the Lord give us good attendance and just great preaching this week. And thankful for the soul that got saved this morning. Isn't that a blessing? Amen. Amen. Well, let me give you just a few announcements. Don't forget, we're going to have a fellowship right after the service in the fellowship hall. There's cookies and ice cream and different things over there. And so I encourage you to stick around and just spend some time together after the service. And then also on Monday night, 5 o'clock, we'll have a meal, 6 o'clock service. And encourage you to bring some food with you. There's sign-up sheets out there. And then Tuesday night, same thing. We'll have 5 o'clock meal and then 6 o'clock service. And let me say this, don't just eat and leave, okay? Amen. None of you would do that, would you? No. No, I'm just kidding. I know nobody would do that, but come on and have a meal with us, and then we'll come and gather around the Word of God each night. Now, Wednesday night, we're going to have just a normal schedule. There'll be no meal. We'll have all of the classes in here. Kids' clubs are going to be in here. The youth group, everybody being here together on Wednesday night, and that'll be the last night of the meeting, and we're just thankful what the Lord's going to do. And let me ask our ushers to come on this way, and we're going to prepare to take up a love offering tonight. You can keep your seats as we're going to pass the plates tonight to take up a special love offering. And so just let me remind you, each night, come on forward, fellas, each night we're going to be taking up a love offering for Brother Cuthbertson to meet the needs and expenses there as he's come. And so it's always a blessing to have guest speakers come, but we want to make sure that they're taken care of while they're here, and then that we send them away with what they need to sustain them as they travel. And so thankful for Brother Cuthbertson this evening. All right, well, I'm going to ask Brother Brian Klink if you'll just ask the blessing on the offering this evening. Amen.
We pray for a revival, and I need a revival, but even if I just see one person get a revival, I'd like to see what a real revival really is.
Yeah, amen.
I pray that you work this week and speak your heart, speak my heart, and work as only you can. We ask you to bless this offering, the gift and the giver. We love and thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you, fellas. Thank you for being here again tonight. We're going to sing a few more congregational songs, have Brother Mike come back, and let's take our hymnals, turn to page number 312. Page number 312, Open My Eyes That I May See. This is a new song for me, and I'm sure Brother Mike knows it well.
Yeah, it's a good one. 312, Open My Eyes. You can be seated. Open my eyes that I may see glimpses of truth thou hast for me. Place in my hand the wonderful key that shall unclasp and set me free. Silently now I wait for thee. Ready, my God, thy will to see. Open my eyes, illumine me. Spirit divine, open my ears that I may hear voices of truth thou sentest clear. And while the wave notes fall on my ear, everything false will disappear. Silently now I wait for thee. Ready, my God, thy will to see. Open my ears.
You're ready for some more good preaching this evening, and I couldn't help but think while Brother Cuthbertson was preaching, he reminds me of one of my favorite preachers that went on to be with the Lord a long time ago, but he reminds me of Oliver B. Green, if any of you have ever heard his preaching, and spending some time with Brother Cuthbertson at lunch today, and just having some small talk. It's just a blessing to fellowship with him, to get to know him more. And I want him to share with you tonight just what the Lord did in his heart and his family years ago when he was here. And I really think that'll be a blessing to the church. And so I want you to share that with him as you come, brother.
Thank you. Amen. Well, you came back, some of you. And we appreciate that. And had a good meal today. And my wife and I, we were going to sing tonight. I play the guitar just a little. They call them the bluegrass chords. If you know C, G, and D, you can pick about anything. But we just didn't have time to practice. We will tomorrow night, so it's good to be here again. And I want to say that it isn't. I don't want to. What was the old song Mac Davis used to sing? It's hard to be humble. I'm not trying to sound humble, but we generally try every time that we leave to go anywhere to preach. Having pastored before, I realize that when a pastor invites you to come, they're putting a lot of trust, obviously in God, but trust in you, me. And I know what it's like, the expenses. I realized when I was pastoring that you only have 52 Sundays. Out of those 52 Sundays, usually your biggest crowd is Sunday morning. And you give the pulpit up throughout the year, 6-7 times or whatever. You get down, you're only before your people for Sundays, the biggest crowd, 30, 32, 33 times maybe. And to give the pulpit up, you really have to be led by God. And we try before we leave to go anywhere to preach, to pray, and I generally always say, Lord, they're investing a lot in us, and I don't want to take it lightly. I don't want to phone it in. I really want to be led by your Spirit, and we come to serve. I've been at churches where I've weed-eated, and I've mowed grass. I've helped the preachers clean the toilets and baptistries, and my wife has babysat and did whatever. As the Bible says that the evangelist is a gift to the church, and we want to be a gift. We want to come and serve. And I told a pastor at a meeting, I think it was last year, I said, wear us out. And I do appreciate pastors that allow us to rest and things like that, but we're here to serve and pray and study, and it's not a vacation for us. We do try to get in a few things that we may enjoy, but our sole purpose is to be a help to God's people. Referring to what Brother Kent had said was when we moved out here at that time, it was me, my late wife. We had four kids. Of course, see, my oldest now is 31, or will be 31. Is that 32? He'll be 32. And so that was some time ago, back in mid-2007, 8, and 9. And we had come out of a situation where we were at in another state, come out of a very wounding, hurtful situation, and at that time we did not know what my late wife was suffering from. She had excruciating pelvic pain, and for years we didn't know what it was. Nobody could figure it out. She had hurt so bad she'd bite her fingers till they bled. She just was in such pain. We didn't know what it was. Now later, when we got back to Arkansas, they found out through sportatory surgery that a hysterectomy she had in North Carolina was, they said, was butchered. That was the source of all that. So we had all that going on, not knowing what was going to happen. And so when we came here, I'd had some offers from others in other churches to come. I had an offer back in Arkansas to come and take a church. But at that time, I felt like I had to put my family above my pride, my desires. And so Brother Hughes had called me and said, hey, we'd never met. He said, do you need a job? And I said, why? Who's hiring? And he said, well, I'll hire you today. And I said, Brother Hughes, you don't know me, but no, I don't want to do that. I said, I want to find a job, and I want to just sit, and I want to see my family and me get ministered to. And so we came, and about 2 weeks after we came, we joined. And I was telling Brother Kent earlier that that first time we came on, I remember Sunday night, he took us to the food bank, and I mean, we left like the Beverly Hillbillies, you know. We walked out of here with steaks, and now some of them were expired, but you know him. Oh, they're still good, you know. You know, yeah. Oh, just cut that black spot out of that apple. It's still good. You know that. And the church. One thing I appreciated was just the friendliness and how that my kids got absorbed. The youngest ones got into Awana and just got absorbed into everything. And then my two oldest that were in junior high at that time got involved, got saved. I baptized three of the four here. And so hurt can happen in ministry. And now 28 years, in fact, me and me and Brother Brian over here, we're talking about somebody we know that's not in the ministry anymore, that had the power of God on him at one time. He got hurt really bad and is in a bad place right now. That could have been me. I have part of our ministry, I said earlier, is counseling. Counsel with a lot of pastors are going through things. Whenever they go through a situation, if their kids, their hearts get hard, or maybe they get out of church or things like that, they're afraid to tell anybody because they're afraid that that is some type of indictment upon them. And, you know, that could have been me. My kids, all four of them right now, could be drunk, in jail, anywhere. And I've got a youngest son that's he's doing good as a man, but he's just not in church like he ought to. But the rest of my children are serving God. And I have to say, oh, by the way, my late wife grew up in Missionary Baptist Church in Southwest Arkansas. Her dad was a pastor 30-something years. She had uncles that were pastors. Grew up in church from the day she was born. Her mom and dad and two uncles, I believe it was, they were in a quartet, Southern Gospel Quartet. It's all she ever knew was church. Super Bowl night, 2009. Anybody know who was playing? Arizona Cardinals were playing. You better know that. They may never get back, but anyway, Arizona Cardinals were playing the Pittsburgh Steelers. We left church here, and we were excited. Me and the boys, we wanted to get home. We had chicken wings, and we were ready. We got home, and my late wife said, can I see you in the bedroom? I already thought, okay, Lord, I'm sorry. I don't know what I did, but I'm sorry. And I'd already prepared to go in there and apologize for breathing. I didn't know. Whatever it is, I'm sorry. And so I walked in, and I'm like, okay, you know. And she said, I'm not saved. And I don't know what Brother Hughes preached on that night. I don't know what it was. But she said, I'm not saved. And so she got saved that night. That was 2009. Who would have thought that, let's see, that was 2009, 2015, June 28th, she'd be in heaven. So all these things happened because of this church. And to see, it doesn't always, transitions don't always work very well. But to see And I know there's bumps in the roads. That's just life. But to see what God is doing here, to hear, we were just, Brother Hughes was in a meeting that we were in, and he was just saying, you wouldn't believe what's happening there at East Mesa. Brother Kent, the church is going good. He said, I believe they're going to go further. We've ever seen it go before. It's just nothing but good. You don't know how that thrills me to be able to come back here and know what this church meant to us. And all of my children, this place is special. So I say that to say that don't ever give up. Don't ever feel like you're not making a difference, because anything and everything that God allows us to do from that point on and however long he allows us to do it, that's fruit that's credited to your account here at this church. And some of you say, well, I didn't even know you. I didn't go to church here back then. That doesn't matter. You're still continuing and helping this ministry to continue. And so I want to thank you for that. That means a lot to us. And I'll tell you one thing, too. We came here in 2017, I believe it was, me and Sister Krista, and Brother Hughes, Sister Mary had not met her. And we came and got here this on a Sunday morning. And they had a big bouquet of roses, which kind of made me feel bad. I had not given her any yet since we'd got married. Roses, and just brought her up front, and just the wisdom that he had, knowing that this would be a little maybe strange for her to come to a place where my late wife was a member, and just basically was saying, you're part of the family too. And so anyhow, that's just been, the church has been great to us. I appreciate that, and I thank you for that. Now, I'm going to try to, you know the famous last words of every preacher, right? This is my last point. And so it's like a barbed-wired fence, you know, just anyway. But I'm going to try not to keep you long tonight. And I heard the story of the little boy that was staring at the wall there in the foyer of the church. He saw a plaque, kind of like a plaque, a picture, just had a bunch of little brass plates and a lot of names on it. And preacher walked by and said, son, what are you looking at? He said, I don't know. What is that, preacher? He said, those are the people that died in service. And he waited a minute and said, did they die in the morning or the evening service? He wanted to know, which one do I need to avoid, right? So, well, this is the last one for today. So if you survive this morning, you're doing all right. I said this morning that revival involves returning. That was Sunday school, how Abraham experienced revival. I said I believe that that was probably the first mention or illustration of a revival, and Abraham returned to Bethel. Bethel meaning the place of God. It exemplified the presence of God, and he returned back to Bethel. I said revival in essence could be summed up like this: getting back to where God wants us to be. And then during the preaching hour, I said that revival involves remembering. Peter said, I write these things to stir up your remembrance. Peter said, even though it may seem hard for us to believe, that it is possible for saved people to get so far away or so much disengaged with God that they even forget that they've been bought by the Lord. Now, I've strayed. I got saved in 1989 and then joined the Marine Corps, and I didn't mean to. I got away from God. I've been away from the Lord. I've backslidden. I was chastened, and God corrected me and dealt with me, but never to that point. But Peter said, I'm writing these things because some of you, you may have drifted so far away, you're so far away in your fellowship with God. I want to stir up your remembrance. So revival involves remembering. Then I said the other word would be revival involves repentance. And it does. And I read one time where a man said this, that the depth of any revival is determined by the depth of repentance by God's people. But as we were just kind of relaxing a little bit this afternoon, God just seemed to change the direction. We're going to kind of stay around the cross a little bit tonight. But revival not only involves returning, and not only does it involve remembering, and not only, we may deal with it this week, does it involve repentance, but revival involves relationship. Relationship.
As I said this morning, revival truly is for the saved, not the lost, though we want the lost to be impacted and affected by the revival that takes place in our life. We saw an example of that this morning with Michaela. But as I said, revival is for saved people, and salvation is not just a ticket to heaven. Salvation is a real, living, genuine relationship with a real, living person. And that person is the Lord Jesus Christ. And so with that in mind, I want us to start here, or we'll basically stay in John chapter 21. I think it was Charles Finney said that revival is falling in love with the Lord Jesus all over again. Here in John 21, in verse number 15, "So when they had dined, Jesus saith unto Simon Peter, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me more than these? He saith unto him, Yea, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee. He saith unto him, Feed my lambs. He saith to him the second time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? He saith unto him, Yea, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee. He saith unto him, Feed my sheep. He saith unto him the third time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? Peter was grieved because he said unto him the third time, Lovest thou me? And he said unto him, Lord, thou knowest all things. Thou knowest that I love thee. Jesus saith unto him, Feed my sheep. Now here in John 21, I would say this is the conclusion of what I would call the Lord's swan song. It begins in chapter 19, which we dealt with in Matthew 27 this morning. Chapter 19 is dealing with the crucifixion, and so in chapter 19, we have redemption provided, and we're thankful for that, are we not? I remember as a young boy, we lived in a trailer park, and my dad had just married his third wife, and I was living in Dumas, Arkansas with my grandparents, and my dad was a boilermaker for Brown & Root, and he'd moved to Pine Bluff, was living in this old trailer park, and so when he got remarried, I moved up there with him. And old rundown trailer park, and I can remember during the summertime, me and the boys, we'd go around pick up old Coke bottles, and we'd dig them out of the mud. We'd find them in the ditches, and I mean we went everywhere because on that Coke bottle it said redeemable. Maybe it was a nickel, maybe it was a dime, and there was a little grocery store, and that was there right there in front of the trailer park off to the side. And the old man there had said, now you bring those bottles in, I'll give you money for them. And I may have to confess, if I hadn't to the Lord, that we may have got some fool, drank them, and turned them in. I don't know that for sure. There was no law against it. And the Bible says where there's no law, there's no transgression. But anyway, we found bottles everywhere we could find them. And we turned those bottles in. Now, those bottles were discarded. Those bottles was of no real value to anybody else. But there was somebody that said, I'll take them, and I'll pay for them, and I'll take them, and I'll clean them up, and I'll repurpose them. And that's what Jesus did for you and I. The devil, the Bible says he came to steal, kill, and destroy, and that's what he did with our lives. And the Savior came by, and maybe it was somebody with a gospel tract, maybe it was somebody inviting you to church, maybe it was somebody knocking on your door, but somebody told you that God wanted you and God loved you, and he redeemed you and redeemed me and bought us back to himself. And so redemption is provided in chapter 19. But then in chapter number 20, the resurrection is promised. Aren't you glad God keeps his word? Aren't you glad that, I heard years ago a man tell this. I don't know if this is the way that it happened, but it sure sounded good. Over in Revelation, Jesus said, I am he that was dead and now is alive and live forevermore and have the keys to death and hell. And someone said that whenever Jesus was crucified and he yielded up the ghost and said it is finished, that Satan led a jubilee and a celebration in the depths of hell, and the demons began to begin to shout and begin to applaud Satan, and they were having a celebration. And they watched Jesus on that first day. Satan still had the keys. Boy, they're excited. I mean, all of the demonic activity and the demons of hell are excited. They finally have put to death the one that was promised in Genesis 3:15. Second day, they're still rejoicing, shouting all through the corridors of hell, and look over and Satan still got the keys. But on that third day, as they're shouting in celebration the death of Jesus Christ, someone looks over at Satan and says, "Where's the keys?" And they look over in the tomb and there's a folded napkin. And there's the linen cloth. Jesus isn't there. Amen? He has risen. Because he lives, we can face tomorrow. Amen. So we have redemption provided in chapter 19. And we have the resurrection as promised in chapter 20. But then in chapter 21, we have revival prompted. This is a great story about revival. Again, revival being for saved people. And Jesus here is prompting a revival within the life of Simon Peter. I want you to notice here that when he addresses Simon, because Simon, we know, had failed, Simon Peter. I love the study of Peter, because there's oftentimes he's referred to as Simon. Then he's referred to as Peter, and I believe that the Holy Spirit of God, as he led the writers to write this down, he's doing that because Simon represents our old nature, and Peter represents our new nature, and sometimes Simon gets in the way, but then there's times, like on the day of Pentecost, that Peter is filled with the Spirit and doing great things for God. And we know how that Simon Peter had said, "Lord, they'll never take you alive." Even there in the Garden of Gethsemane, when he drew out that dagger and he cut off the ear of that Roman soldier, and Peter is full of courage. But then when he's questioned around the fire, he denies and forsakes the Lord. And in verse number 1, after these things, verse 2, there were gathered Simon Peter and then the other disciples. In verse 3, Simon Peter saith unto him, "I go a fishing." Now, I'd like to say, I like going a fishing. I had to walk over to Brother McBay's truck there. I said, "What is that over there?" "That's a fish. Angler. I love to fish." I got into kayak fishing. I won't get into all that. We do a lot of catfishing back home. So it wasn't bad that he wanted to go fishing, but the reason for him to go fishing was. And so Peter says, "I go a fishing." Now, at this point, Peter's still saved, but Peter's not revived. Now, one of the difficulties in preaching a revival is I can't see your heart. Now, the pastor can generally see, and he knows maybe personal things, and he may know areas of your life where maybe you're struggling because of things he sees or things that you've told him in confidence, and he would never share that with anyone, but he doesn't know what's really in your heart. I don't know what's in your heart. One of the difficulties of preaching revival is praying and really agonizing with God. "God, what direction do I need to go?" But the Lord Jesus knows our heart. So the Lord Jesus didn't have to preach a 5 or a 10 or a 2-week meeting to try to finally zero in on what was it that Peter needed. He knew what Peter needed. He needed to deal with the relationship Peter had with him. It's like the husband and wife that were driving down the road, and she's over here and the husband's over here, and the wife says, "You know, honey, I remember whenever we first started dating. You'd come to my house and pick me up. I'd come out. You'd open the door for me. I'd come sit in. You'd get in the seat behind the steering wheel. I'd scoot over and I'd get next to you. It wasn't long before you put your arm around me and I'd lay my head on your chest and you'd tell me sweet nothings in my ear. Now, after all these years, I'm over here on one side and you're over there on one side. What do you think about that?" He said, "I hadn't moved." And I believe that's the way the Lord is with us. Is sometimes if you're saved, you know and I know when I need revival. You know and I know when we're not as close to the Lord as we need to be. And we know that, and we're saying, Lord, I don't understand what's going on. He says, I haven't moved. I've not moved. And so here, notice by way of introduction, he asked the question. Three times, lovest thou me? Now, one thing about this, first of all, this is a very passionate question. This deals with love. Love, that passion, that inward magnetism that draws us to someone that we care deeply about. It is a very passionate question. Love is the most inward, deepest dwelling of all emotions that we have towards someone that we care about. It's a very passionate question. The Lord wants our love to be passionate. He wants our love to be strong. So it's a very passionate question, lovest. It's a very personal question, thou. He's asking Peter. He didn't say John. He didn't say Thomas. He didn't say James. He said, lovest thou. You see, you have to deal with and you have to approach your love for Christ personally. You can't have corporate revival if you can't have personal revival. It's a very passionate question, but it's a very personal question. Now, I could ask it of you, but then it's like the old saying, if I'm pointing at you, three fingers are pointing back at me. So if I ask you tonight, do you love the Lord Jesus? I'd have to ask myself, Sean, do you love him? It's very personal. I mean, imagine if I came up to you, one of you men said, you love your wife? Now, I'm just be honest with you. My immediate response would be yes. But that little bulldog that's still down in me, let me just say this. Those of us that's been in the Marines, we're a little bit crazy. My wife's dad was a colonel in the Air Force. That's pretty prestigious. He worked for SAC. I mean, he way up there. And I told her when we met, I said, now look, it's different with us. We're going to have 14 different coffee cups. We're going to have license plates of Marine on it. We're going to have stickers on the vehicle. We're going to buy hats. We're buying them from Cracker Barrel. We'll buy them at the flea market. We're going to have hats with it on there. I mean, we're just kind of, and we're going to recognize each other. There's a look about us, you know. Now, I know, except for Brother Kent, I don't look like I was in the Marines. But I heard one man say one time, don't laugh, fellas. We'll have your wife pull out your wedding album, see how you looked 30 years ago. We were at the VA hospital just last week. I had to go and pick up some medicine. And I walked back. We had a little grandson. I took him down to do something, walked back. And Crystal was sitting there talking to the guy, and I didn't recognize him at first, so I had to check his situation out. And it happened to be a guy I graduated from high school with, and he was in the Marine Corps. And so we got to talking. Nathan Cook is his name. And I said, you know, we were both in the Marines. I know we don't look it, but we still know how. It's up here. I mean, it's just different with us. So if you were to ask me, do you love your wife? I'd say yes. But then that little bulldog would say, it's none of your stinking business. Is that right? If I asked you that, I'd expect you to say yes, but I'd expect you to say, now, why are you asking? Because I don't think it's any of your concern, sir. It's very personal, isn't it? But the Lord has a right to ask. Do you love me? Very passionate question, very personal question. Very particular question. He didn't ask, do you love the church? Do you love the Bible? Do you love prayer? He said, do you love me? He got right down to the point. Now, let me just say, we're slowing things down tonight. Sunday morning, bigger crowd, visitors, and you load both barrels and you just let it fly. But usually Sunday night's more of the home crowd. And I believe maybe that's why the Lord wanted me to go this direction. So I'm going to be a little slower, but it's on purpose. It's a passionate question. It's a personal question, but it's a particular question. Do you love me? Do you love me, Simon Peter? Now, I've heard for years, in fact, I was in a meeting years ago, and I saw two men just not literally getting a fist fight over this, but a theological mental fist fight over what does that word love mean. And so one man said, well, in the Greek it says this and it says that and it says this. I don't believe that I don't think Jesus is as concerned with the definition of the word as much as the depth of what it meant to Peter. And I understand there are different tenses and degrees. There is love where there is on a human level, I love the world. I want the world to get saved. I have a love for my third cousin because of a blood relation. But then I have a deeper love for my own children. I understand that. But Jesus was not interrogating him so Jesus would know. Jesus is asking the question so Peter would know. And so here, he asked him three times, lovest thou me? Lovest thou me? Lovest thou me? Jesus is concerned that Peter be revived. Peter is defeated. Peter is discouraged. Peter feels like a failure. Peter feels like he's blown it. Peter feels like he's a million miles away from God. Peter, no doubt, at night is thinking about how he used to be so close to the Lord and how he had such faith in the Lord and how he had witnessed such supernatural, miraculous things that God did. And he remembers that. And the Lord is concerned. He wants Peter to be revived. Because without revival, other people's lives are going to be affected. If Peter is not restored and Peter's not revived, there's coming a day not long after this, about 50 days later, where Peter is going to have an opportunity to preach to thousands. And revival is not just about getting more people in the pew. Revival is not just about you stopping this and quitting this. Revival is so that the world can be reached and that lives can be changed because of your influence on others. And revival involves returning and remembering, but revival involves our relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus wasn't trying to get Peter to confess his love. He wasn't trying to get Peter to confirm his love. Jesus was trying to get Peter to confront his love. He was trying to get Peter to come to a place where Peter would come face to face with the reality of how much do you really love me? And if you want revival, you and I have to confront our love. Now he asked three times, lovest thou me? But the first time there's one word that gives us insight to what the Lord really was asking him. It's the word more. You see, you can love Jesus, I can love Jesus, but I can love other things too. So he says that first time in verse 15, lovest thou me more than these. That word more, it means to add, to expand, to go beyond. A good way to illustrate this more type of love is when Paul in Ephesians talks about the breadth and the length and the depth and the height of the love of God. Peter, lovest thou me more than these? We could spend hours debating what is these, what is that? I can't tell you that I know the answer to that. I have an idea. But he deals with his love. I mean, Deuteronomy 6:5, he says, love the Lord thy God with all thy heart and thy soul and thy might. Deuteronomy chapter number 10, verse 12, what does the Lord require? Walk in his ways and love him. So the question here is, do we love him more? If there's anything in our life that we
love more, we need our love to be revived. So what are these love more than these? I believe, first of all, it could be this. Peter, do you love me more than the old life? Because that's what Peter did. Peter went back to the old life. Now, we think the old life, we always automatically think, well, he went back to drinking, he went back to cussing, he went back to carousing, he went back to all that. Hey, Peter just went back to his former days of employment, gainful employment. All he did was go back fishing. But it illustrates this point that the devil doesn't have to get you back in a gutter. The devil doesn't have to get you back to running around and going to those bars and doing those things. All he has to do is get you to do something else. Peter, lovest thou me more than the old life? Maria Dyer was born in China in 1837. And her parents died, and she went back to England to live with her sister. Or her mother's sister, aunt, who was very wealthy and had put Maria in some of the best schools, and so she was to inherit a lot of money someday. And going back to England, she had the finest of everything. She could have stayed, but at 16, a little older, she went back to China. You see, Maria Dyer loved Jesus more than the old life. Well, nothing sinful in being back in England, nothing sinful in having an aunt that was rich, nothing sinful in having a good life, nothing sinful in having plenty of money, nothing sinful in that. This had nothing to do with her wanting to do the things that were against God's word. It's just that she wanted something more than the old life. What is it that if God asked you for it, would you struggle to give up? I've had to face that. When I pastored there in Pine Bluff, we had a good church. We suffered, as we were talking about earlier, smaller country churches, COVID impacted us a lot more, but we were on the move back up. God, I'd been there 13 years, and we'd seen so many saved and lives changed. And be honest, all my kids were within about 30, 40 minutes from me. And if I wanted to go fishing, my in-laws have a cabin on the Saline River. If I wanted to go deer hunting, I go deer hunting. I'm not but about a 45, 50-minute drive from Stuttgart, Arkansas, duck capital of the world, Max Prairie Wing, Biomeda, put on your waders, walk out there and sky blast those mallards out of the sky. I mean, it was good. Hey, man, Arkansas River, those big blue channel catfish. Go out there with a big pin 209 reel. Take a cast net and get your shad and go out there and sit in front of the dam and reel those things in, four hooks on the line at a time. Now, I mean, it's good. Nothing bad about that. Nothing safe about that. See, you hadn't said amen all night, and I started talking about fishing. Now you men started. I even talked about loving your wife. You didn't say amen. I start talking about fishing now. All of a sudden, amen, yeah, all right. Yeah, some of you woke up. I mean, it was good. I'd been there long enough. I knew everybody in the town. It's good. Then I was bivocational, and I had a little carpet business that was doing well. And then I love coffee, and I started roasting coffee and opened up a coffee shop and in town. It's just good life. Grandkids, a lot of times on Sundays, at least one of my our kids would come over, and the grandkids would come over, and it was great. And God began to deal with my heart. A lot of different reasons. But part of it was, I felt like, God, I told Krista a couple years earlier before we resigned, I said, I feel like God is wanting me to step out by faith. And I struggled with that. And so when I finally, 2 years later,
I knew I would preach. I would preach, and I would. I remember specifically preaching one morning, and I said something, and it had to do with trusting God. And God, I mean, as clear as a bell, said, "Are you going to live by it? You're preaching it." And it caught me by surprise. And so I had my associate there, told him what our plans were. We'd already been traveling quite a bit for a couple, 3 years prior to that. And I told him, we set a date, July 31st of last year. And I didn't think, you know, this is how it normally goes. If you pastor going to evangelism, everybody knows you has you in those first 6 months, and then nobody has you in. That's just the way it is. And so I told, the first step was this. I was sitting in that coffee shop, and that was a dream of mine. A little coffee shop. People come in. I love to talk. And I'd have prayer with people. I'd sit there, read my Bible, drink coffee that I roasted, and it was just great. And boy, got it all together, and people were coming, and it was good, and everything was good. And I was sitting there one day reading my Bible, and the Lord said to me, "What are you doing here?" And I thought, "Well, I'm sitting here drinking coffee. You know what, Lord? What are you trying to tell me?" He didn't say, "Lovest thou me more than this," but he seemed to say, "Do you really want me to take you further in your Christian life?" And I remember saying, "Lord, I think I'll do anything that you'd ask me to do." He said, "Lock the door, shut it down." I went home, I said, "That's it, I'm shutting it down." Next day, I moved everything out. That was the first step. Then whenever I knew we were going to leave, I told Krista, I said, "Now, we moved from where we were at in Pine Bluff up to the Jacksonville, North Little Rock, Sherwood area." And I said, "Now, I've still got the little carpet cleaning business." I said, "So if we don't have meetings, I can do that in between meetings." And I remember in the spring of last year, the Lord said to me, "Either you do this all the way and you love me enough to turn your back on it all, or don't do it at all." The old life is not always representative or representation of something evil and wicked. It's, are you willing to give up everything behind you so I can take you further? Is there anything that you would not turn your back on for the sake of Christ? Anything. You see, lovest thou me more, Peter, than the old life? I believe he was also saying, "Lovest thou me more than the old life?" But Peter, "Lovest thou me more than your own life?" He said in verse 18, "Verily, verily, I say unto thee, when thou wast young, thou girdest thyself and walkest whither thou wouldest. But when thou shalt be old, and thou shalt stretch forth thy hands, and another shall gird thee and carry thee whither thou wouldest not." He said, "Peter, do you love me more?" I'm not asking you necessarily, do you love me? I know you have a love for me, but is it a more love, an abundant love, a love that you love me more than your old life? Do you love me more than the things that you desired? Do you love me more than the old life? And do you love me more than your own life? When Maria Dyer went back to China, she married Hudson Taylor. She died at the age of 43. She loved Jesus more than her own life. You say, are you saying, preacher, that for me to really love God, that I've got to go somewhere where I know I'll die? No, that's not what he's asking. I'm crucified with Christ, nevertheless I live. Are you willing to present your bodies a living sacrifice? That's your own life. Are you willing to say, "God, here I am, all of me. You can have all that is within me, all that is about me. You can have my life." You talk about a revival. When we get to a place that He is more important than our own life, our own pursuits, our own dreams, our own desires. See, he's trying to get Peter to experience personal revival.
Did Peter love the Lord? Yes, because grief, I've learned that grief is the price of love. Peter showed great grief when he failed the Lord. I believe that that is a good sign of his love. When a Christian, it doesn't bother them when they do fail God, now that's a dangerous area to be in. No, it's not that he did not love Jesus. Jesus wanted more love. Lovest thou me more than the old life? Lovest thou me more than your own life? And lastly, I believe he's saying in this revival meeting, by the way, lovest thou me more than others' lives? Others' lives. Sometimes it's others that keep us from getting close to God. I don't mean lovest thou me more than other people's lives in the sense that we treat them bad or we turn our back on people that we love. No, he's saying, listen, because Peter said, what about him? The Lord said, don't worry about him. Are you willing to love me more than others? See, we have a tendency of gauging our walk with God against other people's walks with God. We have a tendency to think, well, look how they're living, look how I'm living, and comparatively speaking, I'm doing better. The Bible says it's not wise to compare yourselves among yourselves. You and I will never have personal revival until we get our eyes off of our wives, our husbands, our children, how they are, what their relationship with God is. Personal revival is when we deal with our personal relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. Do I want others to love Jesus more? Yes, but I've got to focus on me loving him more. It's like the old saying, it's not my brother, not my sister, but it's me, O Lord, standing in the need of prayer. So the question tonight, as I said, if we want to experience revival, it does involve returning. Get back to where God has always wanted us. It does involve remembering. When we think about the price that was paid from Calvary for our souls, that ought to stir us and want us to be more devoted and dedicated to the Lord. But then it also revolves our relationship with Him. How's our love life with the Lord Jesus Christ? Do we love him above all else? I have to admit to you, I know that I don't love him as I should. It is a daily crucifying of the flesh. It's a daily laying my life on the altar of God as a living sacrifice. But I want to love him more. I have no sad story to cry to you tonight. I'm not suffering for Jesus or anything like many are around the world. In Egypt, Saudi Arabia, Lebanon, other places around the world. But that's not my fault. That's not my choosing. I just as well could have been born in Kenya or Tanzania, or I could have been born in Somalia. The Lord chose for me to be born here. I haven't had to suffer like others, but I'll be honest with you. There's times where it's hard for us to leave. and we were gone for almost 5 weeks, and we came home for about 10 days. And when we come home, it's all about seeing as many grandkids as we can. And sleeping in her own bed. And I got this one little grandson. He's our MVP. His name is Mason Valentino Perez. His dad's came to this country to play baseball. MVP. And before we left for the long, long trip, they came over the night before we left, and he literally was pulling on me. Didn't want Pawpaw to go. I have to admit, I'm a softy when it comes to them grandkids. We went in the house, I cried a little bit. Sister Crystal was sad. We got to leave. Thank God for FaceTime and all of that. I told all the kids, but I think it was my oldest daughter and youngest daughter, maybe my oldest son, I told him that too. I'm just telling you. So last Monday night, my son's a fireman, and so he only has certain days off, and so I wanted to see him. And so we drove about an hour and 20 minutes to go see him in, near Warren, Arkansas. And I said, son, why don't we go down the Saline River there? We'll fish a little bit. He said, well, I got to work the next day. We'll fish as long as you want to. So we got in that side by side, and he's got four big old catfish poles, and we got some skipjack, and we threw them out, and we're out there all by ourselves. And I mean, but I knew I couldn't stay forever. I said, son, I'm sorry, I'm not home a lot. He said, Dad, it's okay. You're doing what God called you to do. I told my oldest daughter not long ago, I said, I'm sorry that we're not going to be there for a certain event. I said, I'm sorry about that. She said, Dad, I'd rather you be doing what God wants you to do and not be here than be here and not be doing what he's called you to do. And I appreciate that. I'll be honest with you, it's hard sometimes, but I want to love him more. I want to love him more. I want to love him more than my old life. This isn't a big deal, what I'm about to do. This, in the whole big scheme of God and his will and the needs of the world, what I'm about to tell you is nothing, but man, I love deer hunting. I love deer hunting. I'll get up and get out there way before the sun comes up, and I will not leave that stand till the sun goes down. And I do not shoot after dark. Don't worry about that. I haven't been 2 years. I kind of thought, well, when it gets, you know, winter deer season, you know, meetings kind of slow down, but they haven't. I thank the Lord for that. And that's not a big deal. That's not giving up much. It really isn't. It's not. But I hope in some way, maybe just a little bit, it's my way of saying, Lord, I love you more. Nothing sinful about that. You see, loving him more doesn't always have to do with, I love you more, so I'm going to quit doing this sin, committing that sin. Now, sometimes it is. But a lot of times it's just saying, Lord, I love you so much, there's nothing that's more important than you. So if we want personal revival, it involves our relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. He said in Jeremiah to the nation of Israel, Judah in particular, he said, I remember, and I'm paraphrasing, I remember when our love was young, how you ran after me into the wilderness. What he was saying, it was the Lord actually saying to the people of God, Judah, I remember when you would chase after me. Look, I remember as a teenager, I had my dad told me one summer, son, he owned a construction company, whatever your money you make this summer, I'll match it and get you a vehicle. Well, I wanted one of those Pontiac Fieros. You remember those? That's a death trap, man. I look at it now and I think that's the stupidest looking. You know what my dad said? Son, I will not help you buy a car. It's a truck or nothing. Well, Dad, why? You can't make any money with a car. You get a truck, you can rake leaves. You get a truck, you can haul trash off. You get a truck, hey, that's what he said, you get a truck, you can pull a boat. You get a truck, you pull a deer out of the woods, what are you going to do with a car? That's just the way my dad was. So I worked all summer, and you know what I did? I blew all my money on girls. Didn't marry one of them. I got down to the end of the summer, I had $300. So he gave me $300, and I got this old beat-up Mazda pickup. And I thought I was in love with this girl in El Dorado, Arkansas, Junction City, Arkansas. About 2.5 hours away. And it started running hot. And my dad said, son, you save some money up now and go get that thing looked at. It's probably nothing but the thermostat. Maybe it's stuck. I had this trip planned. I was going down there one Friday. I drove down there. And I didn't. He said, you better stop and check that thing, check that water. I didn't. I got down there and went on our little date. About 9:30, 10 o'clock, had to come back. And all of a sudden, that thing starts smoking. Got back home, I warped the heads. So I took it. Anybody ever heard this? I know a guy. Well, my dad said, son, you need to take it here and here and here. And a buddy of mine said, I know a guy. 3 months later, my engine was tore apart and still laying under a tree with a quilt over it. I'd warped the heads. Those Mazda, it was a Ford Courier, but they had a Mazda engine in it. It had aluminum heads. I'd warped it. Had to take it again. She never did run right. So that thing ended up costing me $600 pickup, ended up costing me about $2,000. Piece of junk. I did all that to go see a girl. In fact, I went and seen that girl, and I gave her a little ring. So add that on top of it, plus the gas. And then she finds another guy. All of that for a girl. I mean, I felt like Goober or Gomer on Andy Griffith. You know, he's got a girl, I got a girl, I got a girl. Now that other guy had a girl, my girl. I did all of that because I thought I was in love. And the Lord was saying, I remember when you loved me so much, you'd go to every church service, you read your Bible every day, you kept tracks in your pocket. I remember, Judah, I remember when you chased me, you wanted to be with me so bad. Now where is your love? That's what he's talking about. The more love. Do you know that to really love the Lord, you remember when Jesus said, and I got to hurry and stop, Jesus said, you can't love me unless you hate your mother, your father, we know hate is wrong because if you hate your brother, that's just as bad as murder. No, he was saying, in comparison to the love you should have for others, the love you have for me is so much greater that if you compared the two, your love for other people, your wife, your mother, your children, your father and all that, it would look like you, if people would say, man, look at how much he loves Jesus. He must hate his mother. He was illustrating how much more we ought to love him. That's more love. So tonight, if we're going to have personal revival, we need to confront our love. How much do I love him? More than the old life? More than my own life? More than others' lives? Lovest thou me more? Let's bow our heads tonight. Now, this evening, we've slowed it down just a little bit so we can be a little more reflective. Reflect on our own personal walk and relationship with Christ. And so, right now, what I think would be good is if right now we just didn't do anything. We just took a pause. And we didn't think about what we got to do tomorrow. If we didn't think about what's on Facebook. If we didn't think about what we got to do when we get home. If we just took a moment. And if we would put ourselves on the Sea of Galilee tonight. Just got in from fishing with Peter, James, John, and all the other disciples. And the Lord comes to us and says, Sean, lovest thou me more than these? John, lovest thou thee more than these? Mary, lovest thou me more than thee? Let's just sit there for a moment with the Lord and answer that question honestly. Heavenly Father, It's one thing to say that we love you. I can remember, Lord, growing up, I'd go months and months. I remember one time going almost a year and a half not seeing my mother. She'd be off, run off somewhere. But I can remember every time she'd call me, Lord, she'd say, remember, Mama loves you the whole wide world, and that would make me feel so good inside. And then I got a little older and realized that saying you love me the whole wide world is just words. For us to say we love you, that's good, but unless we follow that with our actions, it's just words. Orders, is there anything that is hindering our love for you? Do we love you like we used to love you? I believe, as Charles Finney said, that revival in reality is just falling in love with Jesus all over again. I think tonight, almost like a husband and wife having a renewal of vows, we need to renew our love. And I'm asking you to deal with each individual heart in a very special, personal, private way. And here in a moment, when we have a musician come to play softly, some of us may need to come to an altar if we physically can and express our genuine love to you and confess where we've not loved you more than the old life, more than our own life, more than other lives. May we leave here feeling like we just got married all over again. Have that honeymoon love again, where we cannot live without being close to you. And when we feel like we are in the smallest way not as close to you as we should be, it would be like living without oxygen. We need you so bad. We ask it in Jesus' name, heads bowed. Just want to say this. The pianist will start playing. Only you and the Lord can meet and deal with this issue of your life. This is about you and Him. Is there anything that's hindering your love for the Lord Jesus? Anything at all? The altars are open. I don't want to assume everyone here is saved, but I will say this, if you're here and you're not saved, no one has ever loved you like Jesus has. And He'll love you like no other. And if you are here and not saved, I want to invite you to come forward here in just a moment. Let somebody take a Bible and show you how to be saved and begin a relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. For those of us that are saved, let me encourage you, if you're physically able and God has dealt with your heart, find your place at the altar and renew that love to Him. Again.
Let's stand to our feet. I want to encourage you. As the piano plays, why don't you come to the altar this evening? The Lord's been dealing with your heart. Why don't you come? Let's have some time of prayer as the piano plays. We'll sing in just a few moments. Let's do business with God tonight. If He's been dealing with your heart, you come on this way. Let's take our hymnals together and turn to page number 314. I want to sing this song together before we dismiss tonight. Page 314, More Love to Thee. Let's start there on the first verse. 314. More love to Thee, O Christ, more love to Thee. Hear Thou the prayer I make on bended knee. This is my earnest plea, more love, O Christ, to Thee, more love to Thee, more love to Thee. Once earthly joy I craved, sought peace and rest. Now Thee alone I seek, give what is best. This all my prayer shall be, more love, O Christ, to Thee, more love to Thee, more love to Thee. Let sorrow do its work, sin, grief, and pain. Sweet are Thy messengers, sweet their refrain. Sing with me, more love, O Christ, to Thee, more love to Thee, more love to Thee. On that fourth verse, then shall my latest breath whisper Thy praise. This be the parting cry my heart shall raise. This still its prayer shall be, more love, O Christ, to Thee, more love to Thee, more love to Thee.
Amen. Wonderful preaching tonight. Listen, I want to encourage you to do this. Go home tonight and spend some time alone together with the Lord. And think about the message that you heard today, both messages, and spend some time and get alone with God. Ask God to search your heart. Ask God to open your eyes to the needs that you have in your life. And listen, I believe when we hear wonderful messages like this, we don't want to just leave it here and go about our normal life and schedule. Listen, take some time tonight and think about what we've heard today. Pray about it. Listen, I want to encourage you, be back tomorrow night, 5 o'clock for the meal, back again for the service at 6 o'clock. I believe the Lord's going to continue to work in our hearts. And thank you for Brother Cuthbertson. Where'd he go? There he is. Thank you, Brother, for the great message. I'm going to ask Brother Mike Gardner. Brother, would you dismiss us in a word of prayer? Ask a blessing on our food there next door. Don't forget, we'll have fellowship right after the service. Amen. You are dismissed.